You should be warned, the upcoming episode will be full of unfiltered, off-the-cuff discussion. As such, you should consider this your spoiler warning.
Hello, my name is Kyle.
My name is Ryan.
And when our powers combine, we form Experience Grind podcast. You know, we're not the only podcast with two nerdy white dudes talking about bullshit that doesn't matter, but we're not the worst. That's not bad. I try to do it a little different each time.
I know. I see this. Yeah. And then I feel like I have to pick up the weight and I never want to. And so I just didn't do it that time.
How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good.
It's getting warm out there now, finally.
It is. Winter's going, you know?
Yeah. And with winter comes the next month, which is spring.
Spring.
Yeah. So, in honor of that, you and I decided we're going to talk about a little-known movie from 2012 called...
Spring Breakers.
Yes.
Is it little-known?
I think so. I mean, yeah, I'd say it's definitely very niche indie. Out of our group... You, me, and Andrea are about the only three I know that have heard of it.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. I watched it for my second time with Mandy. She did not even remember watching this the first time. She argued with me vehemently that she had not seen this movie. I was like, no, we fucking sat right here and watched this. I know it.
Case in point, Fuller House Season 1.
Yeah.
Fair slash enough. Season 2. They're the same.
Man, where were you when I was having this minor
right?
argument
That's what you had to bring
her.
That up.
God damn it.
That's the thing.
I will
you
when
gotta,
I get home.
You
she's
gotta
totally
be with
getting...
Laura. Your argument game. Ups,
oh man,
it steps up.
Laura, fucking Mandy's getting that double barrel chest rock salt to the tits, like fucking
Beatrix Kiddo,
dude. That's a good callback. You like that?
Yeah, it was good.
So no,
we did an episode on Kill Bill. You could check it out. It was episode 10. It's all the way back, but you can still find it.
Damn, you
it's
remember
a good
the fucking
one.
Number?
I made it up. It might not be episode 10, but goddamn, if that didn't sound confident.
Yeah.
As fuck.
I should not have called you out. I should have just let it roll. Yeah. Should have just let it roll. My apologies. That's my fault.
That's
my bad.
That's okay.
So
sometimes
no,
we fumble.
We're going to talk about Spring Breakers, which again came out in 2012, mm-hmm. which is crazy. I did not know it came out that fucking long ago.
5 years.
Yeah.
5 years ago.
I thought this was like 14.
I did too. I thought it was a lot sooner, but I don't know.
But it just
stuck with us, I guess.
I'm very looking forward to talking about this movie with you.
Mm-hmm.
But before we do, I think we have maybe the worst intro question ever.
I don't know. I felt like we had what was the favorite snack food?
That was a bonus round that's never been released.
Okay, well that's
deep
still the
cut.
Worst. That's still the worst.
Deep cut, bro.
I like Cheetos.
Nobody
let's talk
Cheetos.
About Cheetos.
He said cold pizza.
I don't even like cold pizza.
No. Oh, God. Oh. This oh. Is oh.
That's how much thought
right,
I put into this.
All right, man. So the question is, in honor of Spring Breakers, Ryan, with your fucking pocketfuls of money spilling out, did your family ever take any elaborate or any, in general, spring break vacations when you were a kid?
Family, no.
But
and
you?
Yeah, absolutely. I think everybody did spring break after family. Like, you don't do it with your family. You have summer vacations with your family.
Okay.
You don't do spring break with your family unless you have, like, a real fucked up family.
Well, no, a lot of the kids I knew in, like, elementary, junior high, and high school, a lot of them went on spring break with their families.
I guess we have different interpretations of spring break.
Maybe.
As we are talking about the movie Spring Breakers,
yeah.
I'm thinking more of the... kind of party atmosphere.
The debauchery, yes,
yeah.
For sure. But I'm just saying a vacation during the spring break from school.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not with family, though.
Not with family.
Because that's weird.
I never did either. I didn't go to college till like last year, so.
No, okay.
But I'm
it's
curious.
It's because NPR. He started listening. Now he's in college.
Yeah.
Next thing you know.
That's what it is.
He's going to have two mortgages.
I don't know if you guys know this.
Probably three dogs now. He's going to get another one.
I listen to NPR.
He does. He's really smart.
I listen to NPR.
You guys.
But
he's really smart because he taught me how to use a stage whisper.
Hey, man. acting coaching. That's my side gig. If you need him, hook me up.
Business card.
Jacob York. I can teach you how to act, bro. That's a deep cut. You don't know that.
I don't know that.
It's cool.
I was trying to think of some pun to go off of, but...
Anyways, Ryan, so tell me about your spring break. I'm going to live vicariously through you.
Sure. It was probably pretty lame now looking back, but...
You participated in something lame?
What?
I've refused to believe this, sir.
It's true. It's true. And let me tell you all about it.
Oh, God, please do.
So, lame. I'm lame. I did not drink or do anything until college, and it was a spring break trip that I decided, you know what, this is the time. Let's buy some booze, go down there, let's just have fun.
Now, when you say go down there...
I mean to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina.
You are from North Carolina.
So I'm close to the beach. It was like a five-hour drive. Had three of my other friends from college, Harrison, Nate, and Joe. It was a fun trip. Like I said, we had a shitty hotel in the Poindexter.
Fucking A, man.
Got really drunk, clearly underage. They asked for like a $500 down deposit on our room because we were underage.
Were you 18, 19, 20?
I think it would have been 19.
So this was like freshman year of college?
My sophomore year. I was younger than everybody else. I was always the youngest kid in my class. I was born right on the date.
Cool. So I get that.
Man. Which so many things in common, right? I think I had Bacardi vodka, and it was like the vanilla, because I thought like, I don't know vodka. I don't know if I can handle it. I can handle vanilla. It was probably the worst decision because that's never good or smooth or easy to drink. So we got really drunk. We're walking around the boardwalk. Thank you. Really paranoid. I don't know if you know this. When I drink, I get really paranoid.
You didn't. Every time I've been drunk with you, no.
All right. Well.
But I could see it as a younger kid.
Yeah. I think I still do. But maybe I don't. I don't know. It's the paranoid thing. So we're walking the boardwalk. I'm drunk. I'm underage. My friends are drunk. They're underage. And we have one of our friends. I won't say who it was, but it was like going around and like. Slapping at little babies in carriages and shit. I remember him like chasing a pregnant woman who had like a carriage and a baby, and he was like chasing at the baby, smacking at it.
Dude, your friend is a total asshole.
And I look around, and it's like in the Matrix. All of a sudden, I see all these agents, all these cops, fucking everywhere. Like on every corner, there's like a cop car come blazing through. And this guy is running around chasing these babies. I'm really worried that the cops are going to, like, look at me, my fucking dumb baby face, and be like, that's obviously an impaired person. Let's pull him over and check his ID and then probably take him to jail where he's going to have to call his mom and his mom's going to be like, I told you so. And then I'm going to community service, and it just spirals down.
Just a small clarification. Your friend... is chasing random women with babies and strollers and attempting to smack them in the face?
Maybe my memory is hazy.
Okay.
I know for sure at least one, he was chasing at the stroller, and I think maybe he was like trying to do a Gucci Gucci Gacha, but was just like swiping at the babies.
Okay. I'm glad I got that clarified.
So he's swiping at the babies, making ass of himself. Luckily, he gets distracted. He goes to the beach. Like, takes his shirt off, and all I remember is, I think Joe was around with us. He's on his knees, shirt's off, and he's just saying, punch me till I feel. And I don't remember if Joe did or not, but I guess I'll have to ask him.
Drunk college kids are the fucking worst.
God. I think so.
God, they're the worst.
What's even worse than lame about the story... is it was, like, right at the end of, like, everybody else's spring break, but for some reason, ours was, like, at the start. So, like, spring break had just ended for most everybody. And we were, like, the nerds there at the end, where it wasn't really spring breaky. We were building sandcastles the next day. It was so nerdy. I made Luther Corp, but, like, I was drunk, so I spelled it Luther Corp. I left out the H. Joe made some sandcastles. He went out to the water to play, and then I stomped all the sandcastles. And
God said damn
it. A little kid did it, and he was, like, starting to beat up kids.
I'm fucking crying here. This is the fucking stupidest best thing I've ever heard. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. All right.
So, pretty fun trip.
Yeah. Did you surf or boogie board at all?
I think we wake, or we did, what's the thing where you float on your hands?
Where you float on your hands. I mean, there's boogie boarding where it's like half the board and you like hold on.
It's bodyboarding. That's what it is. Well, yeah. This is the thing. We were poor.
Yeah, so I've totally got
college students didn't want to buy boards. So Joe is just like, it's cool. Bodyboarding is a much better ride than any wake or surfboard.
Oh my God. So wait, you didn't actually have a board.
He used his hands to float in the swells of the ocean, and that's what you did. You just had your arms up. You're like, whoa.
Oh my God. Oh my fucking God. This is amazing.
College students are the best.
Yeah. So how long were you there? Like a week-ish?
4 or 5 days. Yeah. 4 or 5 days.
You got hammered the whole time?
I got hammered once really hard, and then I was super paranoid, like I said.
Ah. Okay.
Yeah, I know.
Damn, that's crazy, though. You didn't do it till your sophomore year of college is when you really let loose.
Yeah. I don't think I let loose because like I still like did it once in a while, but like once I turned 21, that's when I could do it guilt free, and it was
fair
liquor store and let's throw fucking parties all the time. Like this is the way to go.
I got drunk my first time as a freshman in high school because of sound engineer Andre over there.
I believe that.
He's my bad influence. Yeah, calling you out. You know it's true. Don't fucking deny it.
Wait, what are we talking about?
I think half the kids in Indiana.
Not half.
Have the story of the first time I got drunk, sound engineer Andre was there.
I know of two. A lot of people were actually very intimidated by Andre because he partied hard. I embraced that lifestyle. I wanted that. I wanted that taste. So we became good friends very quickly. But yeah, the first time I got drunk as a freshman was on fucking Everclear.
Oh. Ouch.
And then I remember,
really?
Yeah. I was drunk and everybody else passed out. And I stayed up all night at the dude's house and played Tony Hawk Pro Skater for the PlayStation for the first time. Like, all night.
That ended nicely. I'm surprised it ended that well with Everclear.
It was great.
Yeah.
Party hard. Play it safe.
Yeah.
Play it safe.
Totally.
Party hard. Play harder.
What? Yeah. Right. But then, like, you know, stick around. Play guitar, play Tony Hawk. You know,
yeah, don't go anywhere.
Don't be dumb.
Just relax.
Don't drink and drive.
Yeah.
Well,
high school sound engineer Andre had a lot of sense.
Yeah. He's lost it over time, but still.
So, sound engineer Andre, were you going to toast there?
Yeah.
Were you going to toast to sound engineer Andre?
Because he's the greatest.
No.
That's swell, guys.
So, sound engineer Andre has a lot of sense, as we have just determined. It also makes sense to go with a business you trust and rely on.
Oh, yeah.
And one of those businesses that we trust is In Case of Emergency
Press. Yeah. So, our bumpers, we are proud to announce that we have our first real official sponsor of the podcast.
We do.
So, the bumpers from here on out for the next foreseeable future will be sponsored by our good friends at In Case of Emergency Press, who are a Bloomington, Indiana print shop founded in 2009. They provide screen-printed goods for bands, record labels, businesses, artists, organizations, and many more, with a focus on custom projects and quick turnaround time at a fair and affordable price. From custom t-shirts, hoodies, tank tops, and other printed apparel, to vinyl record jackets, tote bags, koozies, and so much more, they are capable of screen-printing your design onto nearly anything. They can also perform design work if you have the idea in your head, but are incapable of transferring it to a physical form. They are able to help you every step of the way. So, if you need anything printed on t-shirts, koozies, tote bags, whatever, just go to www.incaseofemergencypress.com and get your project started today. Don't wait until it's an actual emergency. Again, that's www.incaseofemergencypress.com. That was my first official fucking advertising read. I'm pretty stoked on that.
Yeah, that was really good. Also, my ambulance noise was amazing.
Yeah, it was pretty fucking stellar, bro.
Like, should have been louder. But it's actually not that good.
So,
thanks.
Thank you, In Case of Emergency Press, for your faith in our show. We hope it returns dividends to you. And so you guys are going to be sponsoring this next thing, which is our bumper. It's our bumper music featuring music from the movie Spring Breakers, which is the song Ryan What are we going with here?
Oh, do I get a pick?
Yeah.
Oh, no, there's so many choices.
There are? Andrew wants to pick? All right, Andrew's going to pick. Yeah. I know what he's going to pick, but I'm okay with it.
I also feel like you didn't give my ambulance noise a lot of credit.
Ooh. Oh. Oh.
Sound engineer Andrew, what are we going to hear?
Oh, man. I love this song. One, I think because of the film being based around Dangerous, it's good that like a Dangerous song makes it into the soundtrack. And then it also has James Franco, who I love and adore.
Yes, yes,
singing along. Yeah. I mean, he's great. So I think today's bumper ought to be "Hanging with the Dope Boys" by Dangerous and James Franco.
Totally love it. So here is Dangerous by, or I'm sorry, "Hanging with the Dope Boys" by Dangerous and James Franco.
While Peter Piper was picking peppers, I was selling Yole at the corner store. Whoa. I started out with 35 grams. Still got about a half a hole to go. My dope locking, my fort talking. Crack dancing, it's moonwalking. In the alley, serving buddies. Chicken heads, balk balking. Junkies at my door. They know the secret knock. Here go. One time for the reefer. Two times for the rock. Baking soda, my best friend. My fork is my fiance. My crack pot singing dance. I call that bitch Beyonce. Get an ounce for $8.50, but the super clean cost a stack though. If your money right and you see the light, knock two times at the back door. My pants sand and my ass show. Jeans fresh out the cleaner. But you need some beans and weed, a couple grams of that Tina. My first gift was a toy stove. My first word was Pyrex. Used to weigh it on the digit, time it on the Timex. My whip game so sick, man. I swear, boy, no joke. Sometimes I videotape it and play it back in slow motion. Cause I'm hanging with the dope boys, hanging with the dope boys. My motherfucking wrist go ham, ham. Hanging with the dope boys, hanging with the dope boys. Hanging with, hanging with, hanging, 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 hanging.
All right, so that was The Dope Man by Dangerous.
Hanging with the Dope Boys.
Hanging with the Dope Boys, Dangerous.
I'm getting pretty deep
James
in this bottle
Franco.
Of vodka. God. So, yeah. With Dangerous and James Franco. So, man.
As a child, I used to play with a James Franco yo.
Oh, yeah? And what?
It's a yo-yo.
Oh, I thought. Like,
you said Franco.
Yeah.
James well, Franco yo-yo. That's what I heard.
That's the way Andy and I say James Franco. We would routinely scream it into trash cans at work.
Oh, really?
I'm James Franco.
Why does he sound like Sean Connery?
We don't know. It was just funny, and it was really more to annoy the other people we worked with. That's what we really kind of got off on.
Fair enough.
So,
fair enough.
If you can believe that.
Yeah. At the time, it was sort of like James Franco is so full of himself.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe perhaps still so. But, you know, I like the guy.
I fucking love
him. He's a good actor, yeah. But, you know, we were totally poking fun at his big ego.
For sure.
So,
for sure.
Anyway, go ahead.
But anyways, so we're going to talk about a movie. I have no idea how we're going to talk about this.
Gold.
Spring Breakers.
Gold.
Which is a 2012 movie by the director Harmony Korine. It stars, of course, James Franco, y'all. Selena Gomez, Vanessa Hudgens, Ashley Benson, and Rachel Korine.
Sure.
Sure.
She's somebody. Not just wife of the director and in the movie, needlessly.
Yeah, she's one of the four main characters, though. She's going to get a name drop.
She's in a lot of the movies.
Other Harmony Korine. Oh, yeah. She's in Trash Humpers.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But
that's why I'm not familiar with her.
Of course, Harmony Korine. He directed, I think, also famously, Kids.
He wrote it. He did not direct it.
Did he not direct it?
Mm-mm.
Well, IMDb lied to me. But he did direct Gummo.
He did direct Gummo.
Which is also an incredibly weird movie. Those are, I think, his two most famous movies. So,
have you seen? I've seen Kids. Have you seen any of the ones he's directed, like Gummo or?
Gummo's really it. Gummo, Kids, and Spring Breakers are. Okay. I'm familiar with Harmony Korine and his work and his... He's also a member of that film group that I believe the dude that directed Antichrist is, which is like Film 56
Dogma 95.
Dogma 95.
Yeah. And it was just the one movie.
Really? He only did one movie.
Julian Donkey Boy.
Okay.
And it was like loosely based on Dogma 95.
Well, Dogma 95 is like a whole way of shooting film where you don't use like artificial lighting. Mm. There's no CGI. It's like a very, very avant-garde style filmmaking. It's natural.
Harmony didn't meet the criteria for live music.
Okay.
He had like canned recordings that people acted to.
Fair enough. All right.
Sounds very hipstery.
It is incredibly hipstery, but I know, again, I can't remember.
Lars von Trier.
Lars von Trier, thank you.
Antichrist.
Big nymphomaniac.
Big hipster.
Big hipster, but
big fucking hipster.
He follows the Dogma 95 pretty hardcore. A lot of his movies fall into that category.
Okay.
But anyways, we're not talking about him. We're talking about fucking Harmony Korine and Spring Breakers.
Yeah.
So. I guess my first question, Ryan,
you said you know how to start this. I don't know.
Did you see this movie in theaters?
Sadly, I did not.
I did not either, unfortunately.
It's one I had heard about constantly in like other podcasts I listened to. Just many good things. And it made me think it wasn't going to be this weird movie I didn't want to see. Because the trailers, like, they didn't sell me on it. It just looked like... there's like a 21 and over movie, Project X, something like of those dumb movies. Yes. It looked like that, but with like a bunch of girls from the Disney Channel and James Franco. Not enough to get me interested, but hearing all the positive reviews did get me very interested in it. And I was like, okay, so there's more to it. I'll give this a shot. Like, let's see. So I waited until it came out on Blu-ray and DVD because I was working at Family Video at the time. And as soon as it did, I watched it right away and fell in love with it. It is, I think, a fantastic piece of exploitation film slash like art house film.
There you go.
In this weird combination that shouldn't work, but I think it does incredibly. 2013 is when I saw it. It would have been my favorite film I saw that year. I loved it. Yeah. I just flat loved this movie.
So here's a weird thing that I noticed, especially on second viewing of this movie. This movie is almost, I would call it like an anti-movie. It doesn't flow and fall into tropes that you feel. There is zero character development in this movie. None at all. We're going to argue this if you feel.
I think there's some character development.
Everything.
It's just not as important as
we came to the beach.
Yeah.
We found ourselves.
They don't even
grandma, we're themselves. Having a great time.
Yeah. There is no like growth, which is fine. And it works for this movie because
I'm gonna argue you're wrong and you're missing the fundamental themes of this movie.
All right, well, and that's good. I want to argue more about it. Because that's what makes these episodes good. I'm not saying it's bad, but what you see is generally what you're getting. But there is some depth.
You're saying this is a surface.
All right. This is good.
Get your point out.
So
I'm sorry to interrupt you.
So this movie starts off with a barrage to your senses with this fucking crazy dubstep song.
Skrillex.
And
Scary Monsters and Nice Sprites. It's fantastic.
There are fucking...
Some people say it should have been the bumper music, but I want to hang with the Dope Boys, I guess.
I prefer hang with the Dope Boys to myself. Oh.
That's great.
But,
and then they recall that music at the end, but it's like a soft orchestral version. Perfect.
I did a poll at work today. I had people listen to the different songs of the soundtrack.
No. Was the poll of one and it was yourself?
No. There were three people polled. One person said they were all terrible. And one person said Hanging with the Dope Boys. And I also said Hanging with the Dope Boys.
So the poll of three people included you. So it was only two other people.
Yeah, that's
and
a pretty good
them
poll.
And hated them all.
So
awesome.
But this movie starts with a complete barrage of your senses. It hits you with this super loud Skrillex song. And there are tits on screen. There's ass on screen. There's people drinking a lot of fucking alcohol. There's drugs being taken. And it's like a good 2-3 minute opening segment of just this. And it's rapid, quick cuts. It's a lot of movement. And It's meant to overwhelm
Isn't
you.
Isn't it kind of like slow motion, very stylized?
Yeah, but then there's a quick cut to a new group. And it, yeah, it's a lot of focus on tits, a lot of focus on pussy, a lot of focus on ass.
Why do you think that is?
Because I think for the most part, especially a Spring Breaker kid, that's what they're going to focus on, especially if the male and the females are going to be like trying to attempt to show that off, especially when they are under the influence. Like, oh yeah, you want to see these titties, things like that. So it's really lasering in on that, giving you this Spring Break experience right at the start.
Moreover, I'll add, I think it replicates music videos.
Sure.
A lot. Okay. And I think totally it's a commentary on like music videos and popular culture. Like, this is what you want. This is what you expect from a movie called Spring Breakers, you dumb youth. Because I think there's a large resentment towards youth culture in this movie.
For sure. Totally give you that. Yeah.
And that's why we get that at the beginning. And then we get the harsh cut immediately to like
college life.
College, cold, bland, drearily shot scenes.
The hallways and the dorm rooms and the fucking boring ass lectures. Mm-hmm. So that's where we meet our four antagonist. I believe is the first scene the prayer scene with Faith. Is that where the first cut is?
I think so.
We meet Faith, who is played by Selena Gomez. She's a very a Christian girl. She's a very godly woman.
Yeah. Loosely.
And yeah, sure.
Fucking loose youth group too, because aren't they all sitting outside a smoke stop smoking, talking about like, oh, these bad bitches, you need to be aware of them.
Two of them.
And they're smoking. It's like,
with her.
Bitches are Christian. Like, you shouldn't be smoking. Like, that's
man, everybody's got their vices.
Desecrating your body.
Christians aren't perfect.
Christians don't desecrate their body for the Lord. You can't get tattoos, you can't imbibe, and you can't smoke.
They all do that because Jesus is forgiveness, Ryan.
Well, that's what you say. Like, on your deathbed, like, I'm just gonna, I'm
good.
I'm
gonna phone this one in, thanks, Lord.
And that's when you get struck by fucking lightning and die on the spot. You sons of bitches.
So we meet Faith, and then we cut.
A tangent.
We cut to her two, they're not her roommates, because she's room with somebody else, but her two friends, Candy and Britt, who are played by Vanessa Hudgens and Ashley Benson. And they are at a lecture, and they are also bored. But the main theme of it is that they are all bored in this stagnant universe that they are in, which is the college life. The boring, the humdrum, the gray, the fluorescent light. They want to escape to something bigger. They want more.
The familiar. Yeah, this is too familiar. It's repetitive. And it's so brilliant, because then you get the repetitive scenes.
That's what I fucking love. All right, so that really starts to drive through.
Yeah.
Well, and then also when they say a line,
yep,
it is almost always, if it's important, they're going to repeat it 3 to 4 times.
Yeah, settings too. When these girls start to leave one by one, they always leave the same way,
on the same bus,
on the same bridge. Yep. It's all purposeful, and that's why I think a lot of people will be turned off by this movie, because it is very gratuitous. It is over the top. It is hyper violent. It's hyper sexualized. It's all that. But it is all intentional. It's all to prove a point.
Exactly.
And that's all for the sake of like getting a message across.
And that's my original point, where I was saying that there's really no character growth. And I think that is also going to be a thing that turns people off from this movie, because at a whole, like, they don't go through anything really.
Incorrect. Right. They do go through growth, and the ones that go through growth are then exited from the film. That's what it is. It's the characters you see and stay with the most do not exhibit growth, and I think that's where the statement comes from. You have Selena Gomez like giving the option to get out when things get like too real with Alien, and she like learns something about herself. She grows, and then the movie cuts her out. The one girl gets shot. Like, decides it's too much. Like, this is not for me. She has growth. She gets cut out.
See,
and that's the film.
I would disagree. It's not the growth. They just realize that this is too much for them, and they choose to exit. They don't want this. So, and it ties in. One of the first things that you hear in this movie is when Faith is at this youth group meeting. Mm-hmm. The preacher says, when you are tempted, he will provide you a way out. And they're talking about Jesus. Jesus will always protect you if you are tempted. He will provide you a way out. And these girls go in to the devil's lair. They go into hell. They are going into the belly of temptation. Mm-hmm. And some of them can't take it. And they take the way out. They are returned to the flock, so to say.
Yeah.
It's, there's a lot of allegories between heaven, hell, God, the devil. That's the big heavy-handedness in this movie, I feel.
A little bit. It's, I mean, yeah, you're right. It is heavy-handed. It's on the nose. But I think it's done so well stylistically. Yeah. It's like, yeah, these scenes are repetitive, but they're shot differently. Like, you see, like, the party scenes with tits and ass and guys grabbing their junks and all this stuff, doing beer kegs and all that. Like, you see that, but, like, each time it's done a little differently. Like, there's a twist to it. Like, mm-hmm. there's, like, a stylistic thing done differently. And it, each time the stylistic choice is done, it's for a reason. So, like, you have the opening that's in slow motion that's, like, very cool and, like, chest pounding. Like, that's fucking awesome. And then you get the cuts, like, oh, wait, that's not what this is about, this movie. And then you get, like, another party scene, but, like, the lights are red and it's right before, like, the almost kind of rape of a character that we like. And then there's, like, another one where it's, like, very trippy, like, they're on acid because they just... And it all ties in thematically, but, like, they're each very different and very, I think, engaging in different ways, if that makes any sense at all.
Again, I think if I was to pick a main theme for this movie, I would honestly think that religion is the main driving theme.
I'd think it's an outcry against the youth culture.
Okay. And that's...
Yeah.
So based on my, and yours is going to tie into this too, your interpretation. My first question for this movie, well, I guess let me set this up a bit first. Sure. So the girls don't have money to go to spring break, but they desperately want to go to a spring break. So how do they solve that problem?
Robbery.
Yes. So three of the girls decide that they're going to go rob a local restaurant.
Yeah.
And the three that partake are Candy, Britt, and Cotty. The only one who doesn't is Faith, who's Selena Gomez. They actually surprise her later because they finally have the money, and they tell her how, and they recreate the scene, and that becomes another big thing of this movie is the reenactment of their first robbery.
The false narrative.
Yes.
The MTV-ification of it. It's quick cuts, very shaky cam, like action-based oriented.
But the when first it's happening,
in reality, it's
very,
very
straight. Very.
It's that long take as the car is going around. It's fucking very,
oh, it's so good. Mm-hmm. So they rob a restaurant and they get the money to go to spring break and they all decide they're gonna go. But before, I think it's before they do that, or once as soon as they get there, one of the first parties they go to. They're taking, like, beer bongs and smoking, like, weed and drugs out of baby dolls.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Now, I'm curious, what did you take from that?
That's when my friend was grabbing at that baby in the carriage.
Exactly, right?
It had weed in it.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I get it, man.
What did I take away from that? I think it's the perversion of youth. I that's this whole movie is... and I don't know if you want me to go into it now or later or save it or what, but, like... It is a baby doll, like something we know as children, being perverted.
That's childish,
and used to do drugs and get high and do everything. But, like, that happens constantly. We have, you know, like the ski mask they use, have the pink unicorn, very cartoony, girly. Mm-hmm. Like, these girls, before they do this robbery, are, like, watching some cartoon. Like, is it a Hello Kitty cartoon?
No, I believe it was My Little Pony.
My Little Pony cartoon. Mm-hmm. But they have, like, Hello Kitty backpacks on. Like, it's... The big,
they're very bubblegummy.
They are, and it's very kiddish. It's very childish.
Okay.
But it's youth and it's perverted. And I think the ultimate scene of that is what you wanted the bumper music to be, which was James Franco and three of the girls singing Every Time by Britney Spears. And Britney Spears is somebody who is either, you look at her like she's a youthful woman. She looks kind of like a kid. The baby One More Time, she was like a little schoolgirl. But like us, we recognize her from our childhoods. And it is in this montage of, like, horrible crimes and dirty shit. They are perverting our childhood. And I think that's the point of this film is...
They also are literally playing Ring Around the Rosie with guns.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, exactly.
It's a child's game with a very deadly weapon.
Exactly.
Okay. I like that. I like that. My interpretation I took from it... Again, I was approaching this much more from the religious aspect of it.
Okay.
I took the dead babies... Oh, I spoil it. Dead babies. I saw them. It was almost like a purgatory. So, like in the Catholic religion, purgatory is where unbaptized babies go to. It's like, it's not heaven, it's not hell. It's sort of in the middle. So, this was like almost their first stop before they really get down into the dark. They've left the heaven, the safety of their college, and they have entered into a purgatory with these dead babies that they're taking like all these drugs and boost things for. And that's what I interpreted these baby dolls as before they get into hell.
Now,
which is the trueness of spring break.
I know you have questions, but I kind of want to stay in this for a minute because
please
this
do, yeah.
is very fascinating to me because I've never read this movie in religious allegories.
Oh, like, man,
I've
they
never
are
seen this.
Fucking swimming in
so,
religious allegories. Because
like I said, I was like so into my thing. I was like, this is clearly what it is. Well, all right, so if this is the religious allegory, then James Franco is alien. Like, what is he? Is he Lucifer?
Yes,
or?
He is the tempter. He is the devil.
So what does that mean with his end at the movie?
I will get into that ending because
okay.
I have a great
so put
interpretation.
A pin in that.
Yes. But just to come back to this, I believe that Gucci Mane as Archie is God. And there's,
no shit.
There's a, because when they meet at the strip club, Gucci Mane specifically says, I created you and you are trying to come against me now, which is exactly what Lucifer does in the Bible.
Oh my God. You have, you are
yeah,
maybe
bro.
Turning me on to this viewpoint. I think that's
I'm telling,
brilliant.
That is an exact word. I created you and now you think you can step up to me, which is exactly what happens in the Bible, bro. I'm telling you, James Franco is the tempter. He is the devil. Gucci Mane is God.
I think this is...
Because Gucci Mane has right. all the power, he has the big house, he has all the women's, he has everything he could ever want. And everything that Alien wants is what Gucci has, or Archie. That's what he wants. He wants that power, and he strives for it. And we'll come back to his ending a bit when we get more to the ending. So this... I'm telling you, dude, this movie is fucking
this
a watch.
This has already been, religious. Like, the best podcast we've done, because, like, I've actually learned something. For the first time, I've learned something. This is amazing.
I want you to watch this movie again now with
I
these allegories. It's
want
fucking
to.
Crazy.
I think I could dig deeper into this. This is great.
Yeah.
This is
so
great.
You want to get your mind blown more. Pink in this movie turns into the color of God. Like. And this I stole all this right, more
so
from internet interpretations.
Interesting.
But
so like the big pink haze at the end is
the big
God
pink
overcoming
haze,
and letting
the dock that they walk up to is pink on the way to heaven. It leads to God. Gucci's in the bathtub. So check this out. He's in the bathtub.
I'm checking this out.
It's a pink color. He's in a bubble bath, which are symbolic of clouds, which is God sitting in the clouds. Once, all right, spoilers alert. Once he gets killed, once Archie gets killed, the next time we see him, lights are off. It's daylight. There are no, because God is dead at this point. In this universe, I would also like to state this all takes place within its own universe.
Sure, sure.
So.
Okay.
Some of this is internet interpretation. A lot of this is my own. To be, I really fucking like this movie.
So what does it mean when James Franco is doing the every time on the piano and they all have pink ski masks in? Why is there God in that scene?
Because they haven't given it up. You notice at the end, once James Franco takes the bullet, they don't have the ski mask. They have given up everything from God. They are ready to take over this mantle and go for it. They're not wearing the ski masks on the final assault. They have given up any shred of redemption that they had.
I wonder then if on the bus scenes when they're going back, when the two girls leave, is there pink on the bus, or
there
is
definitely
the pink
isn't,
on their
colors? And for sure, Cotty's hair, because Cotty's
yes,
hair is
Cotty's
pink the
is
whole
pink,
time.
Yeah,
and I believe, I'm pretty sure Selena Gomez is wearing her pink sweater.
Okay.
On the way home.
Okay.
Because they are returning back to it. I'm almost positive. So.
I really, really like this interpretation.
It's fucking wild, dude. I'm telling you.
This is why I love movies.
So go, and that's why I think the babies really kind of represent almost a purgatory because they are not there yet. But they're like in that in between, like, so it's fucking it's crazy shit, man.
Very nice.
So that was a lot of my notes right there.
Oh,
so,
that was
let's get in more what you've got.
I just have and this is the thing. You did good. You asked questions that led to like good discussion. I just have fucking statements and like train of thought bullshit.
Please give them to me. Let's hear some of these. Let's talk about them.
James Franco playing Alien, commentary on the American Dream.
For sure.
Look at my shit. I want more. I'm not satisfied with what I have.
Exactly.
Getting. I think it's brilliant.
And that again.
His narcissism, right?
That will play into my interpretation
which
of the
Lucifer.
Ending.
Which is Lucifer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there's other things too.
I read that, like, the scene where he's talking about all of his stuff, the original cut was 45 minutes long.
I totally believe that.
And he's talking about, I got blue Kool-Aid. I got polo shirts and this color and this color.
And my dark tan and Noros.
Such an intense character.
It's great.
What I love, too, and again, this is more of the devil, because generally the devil is regarded as a very, he tempts you, and one of the greatest tempts that you have in your life is sexual gratification, things of that nature. At one point in the movie, the girls bring out guns, and they start to threaten Alien.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, what if we kill you?
The weird fallacy thing, too. So you could also go into, like, it's a commentation on sex.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. And that's what I'm saying. The devil
female
is...
empowerment.
The devil is a big sexual being, and he uses sex as a power to get what he wants. And that's exactly what happens in this scene, because they're trying to threaten him, and he uses sex by performing fellatio on the guns to turn it back to his favor.
Yeah.
Fucking, oh my God, dude. He totally turns that scene around by fucking sucking on that gun like a cock. And it totally disarms them, and they're back on his side, and he is back in control.
Interesting way to see it, because I've always seen that scene as them becoming the more masculine ones and emasculating him, making him do this thing that would lower him. Because in the end, like, spoiler, we already know, he dies, he goes out like a bitch real quick, and you have these two become, like, heroes in this world. Like, taking down everybody, like, there's no problems. And
again,
I think it is this female empowerment
thing. I have a great interpretation of that. I will
all
get
right.
to when we get to the ending.
All right.
I think I've got that figured out,
okay.
too. But that's
okay.
just me.
Okay.
Again, man, I fucking love this movie. So, spoilers alert,
yes.
I love this movie.
No, it's fantastic. And what we've already done here is why I love movies in general, but, like, this movie and movies like this,
yeah,
like, it's a movie that you can read completely surface level and be, I guess, thrilled because of the way it's shot or disgusted or whatever, but, like, it provides conversation. It has different ways to view it, and I think that's cool. That's
yeah.
real cool. I dig that.
That's why I love having this show, because you and I, we just talk and shit
yeah.
like that. That's fucking
yeah.
amazing. You show this to regular Joe Smo on
yeah.
the fucking street, and he's going to be like, oh, what the fuck was this? This is stupid.
It was when it came out from a video, it was the Ryan's pick of the month.
Nice! Nice!
And I
high
had
five on that.
So many fucking refunds and returns I had to do because of this movie. Almost like 99%. I think I had 30 people rent this movie because it was my recommendation. Only one person enjoyed it. Every single other person complained and wanted their money back. Which is really disheartening, and that's why I fucking hated working at the video store.
Yeah, that sucks.
Because Paul Blart Mall Cop 2 was so fun. I literally heard one guy, like one fucking 13-year-old kid walking around the store talking about Grown-Ups 2, being like, remember beer burp fart sneeze? Oh, that was the best thing ever. And
oh
just like
God.
Shit like this you hear, and you're just like, fuck my life. Or we're like,
I remember
there's no reason to be here.
Trying to argue the fucking white trash idiot out of renting The Witch, because I was like, you're not going to like it, dude. You're not... I'm not going to sit here and call you stupid, but you're fucking stupid.
So
you won't even begin to appreciate it.
Yeah.
So, but I don't know, man. Like, oh my God, there's like, I love the Britney Spears aspect. I think the Britney Spears definitely plays into the childhoodness, but also plays into the innocence-ness of it. Because Britney Spears
yes.
was, for like 99% of her career, was like the squeaky clean artist. She was.
And then she turned.
I mean, she...
Then she got dirty, but not dirty, because that was Christina Aguilera.
She wasn't like ex-Tina, but for sure. All right, so I don't know. I feel like I kind of dominated this conversation. I know you have some more notes. I would like to hear some more of your interpretations. I think just seeing it as the youth culture, it is an aspect of it, but I think it's very surface level. And this movie wants you to think that it doesn't have the depth that it really kind of does. I told you I went really kind of nerdy with my film analysis hat this film.
No, and that's great. I think you did. I wouldn't say it's surface level to think this movie is speaking out against the youth, because
yeah.
I think there's a large subset of audience members who are fucking stupid who will not pick up on that. And then
a big part of this movie too is the corruption of two well-known Disney stars.
Yeah, right.
Like,
Selena Gomez and Vanessa Hudgens.
Yeah, which
who are both I think, still contracted with Disney at the time that this
were
was
they?
Being
I
shot.
I don't remember that, but man.
One's on Wizard Show.
Wizards of Waverly Place.
Yep. Uh-huh. I knew it was a Wizard.
That was Selena Gomez.
And the other one, I honestly don't know what she's been in. Is she a High School Musical
crazy?
People?
Yeah, she was High School Musical, I'm sure.
I don't know if she has a show or anything.
What's crazy is that fucking Hermione was also slated to star as the Brit character.
Is that Emma Roberts?
Yes.
Brit. Emma Roberts.
Or is it? It's not Emma Roberts, is it? It's Emma something.
You're going to say Emma Watson.
Emma Watson. Emma Watson.
No, but I think it's Emma Roberts.
No, it's, no, Emma, it's Watson. Emma Watson.
It's Emma Watson.
Emma Watson, yeah. Who is Hermione from Harry Potter.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Was supposed to be the Brit character. But when
Brit, because she's British?
I don't think so, but maybe. But when, you know, they have that three-way in the pool with James Franco, and they're all fully nude, she wouldn't do that. So no. They didn't cast her. They went with Ashley Benson, who
does she's pretty, fine.
Yeah, she I dig it. Job. Yeah, it's good for me.
I don't know who she is outside of this movie, though, in all honesty.
Yeah. Well,
like, I'm at least familiar with Selena Gomez and Vanessa Hudgens. I have no idea who the fuck Ashley Benson is.
I actually really liked her and Rachel Korine as Cottie, man. Like,
Rachel Korine was fine for she kind.
She definitely got the
fine.
Role because she's Harmony Korine's wife.
And I think you can feel that in her performance. Like, she's easily outclassed.
She's it's also like, the only one that gets naked.
It's when Kevin Smith does a movie. He has like Chris Rock and George Carlin. And all these people, and then Jason Mewes, and you're like, well, you're clearly the friend. Like, you don't belong here. Like, you are outclassed, and it's fine. Like, Jason Mewes is fine, but he's no goddamn George Carlin or Chris Rock or Jason Lee or anybody like that.
No.
And you put him next to him, and it's
but here's the, totally different tangent. Talking about Kevin Smith movies, who's the fucking character that people talk about the most?
Jay.
It's gonna be Jay.
It's
man.
Gonna be Jay. I was gonna answer
people
that.
Because fucking people talk about Jay.
Fucking stupid.
I'm
Jay is the surface level jokes.
Yeah.
He's the surface level.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But a lot
and that's
of
that's fine.
Know,
that's and that's fine. That's I'm glad
that's what goes
liking
popular.
Kevin Smith movies at all. Yeah. Person on the street, but you shallow. You basic. Fucking learn something.
Give me some more. Let's talk about more of your notes, buddy.
So again, like I don't have coherent points. I just have things I'm reading through. So this movie is all about excess, and I think it's similar tonally to Wolf of Wall Street.
Okay. Yeah.
So then, by that logic point, Jordan Belfort is the devil? Is Lucifer?
I could see that.
No, I don't know. But it's all about, like, the excess wanting more. And it's this stylistic over the top. Like, you're like, yeah, this is fucking fun and awesome. Like, I love this. But, like, wait, maybe I shouldn't. Like, this is not good. And I know the movie's speaking out about it. But it's kind of fun to just inhabit a world with these people for a little bit. I love the DTF pants. On the every time scene.
Yeah.
I think that's a fantastic small touch that, like, made me... fucking lose my
I
shit
wish I
laughing,
had those pants.
Right? Yeah. I'd wear them. Yeah,
I totally would wear those DTF.
Maybe that'll be our picture. We'll make some DTF pants.
Totally into that. Yeah. And we'll wear the pink leopard print onesies.
I like this. I like this a lot.
I'm fucking into that for sure.
You covered the Disney stars. I think that's fantastic casting. Again, it goes to like the perversion of the youth.
Kudos
like,
to both of them for actually fucking doing it.
Absolutely.
That, I mean, I get absolutely. Like, blah, blah, blah. Actors don't want to be known for one role. You broke that mold with this role, girls. Way to go.
I have some lines. The one I love is just fucking pretend it's a video game.
I'm so glad you're talking
right?
about this. I'm so glad you're talking about this.
Video games experience.
Because it's going to come back. It's going to come. Not only that, she says, pretend it's a fucking movie. Pretend like it's a fucking video game.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think that's fucking fantastic.
Hold that thought. Hold satire. That thought. But give me just a little bit more.
That's it. I mean,
okay, that's
it. Like, it's just a great witty,
so
witty insight into.
I think Andrew has something he wants to say. But before that, I just want to say again, holy fuck, I love James Franco as Alien.
Oh, he's perfect.
He fucking adores this role.
You know, we're talking about all the movie and the story and the deeper stuff, the meanings behind this movie. But like performance-wise, I think this is one of James Franco's best, and I think it's a fantastic performance. This is, I think, the same year he did 127 Hours.
It was, I think, he did that the
close.
Next year. Yeah, I think
but
he did
like,
that the year after.
This is like unrecognizable James Franco.
I know, dude.
And it's so good.
It's so fun. Like,
yes, it's a memorable character. Like, if I was into Halloween, I'd go as James Franco as Alien.
Yeah.
Because it's so good.
Yeah.
It's so good. I think it's iconic. I think it's one of the most iconic performances in his career. But, like, of the 2000s so far, like, I think it's fantastic. Maybe hyperbole? I don't know.
No,
but, like,
I
think it's really good.
Totally get you. It's my favorite James Franco performance, easily, hands down. So.
I think you say, like, Spring Break Forever, y'all.
I would say it all the time.
Anyone who's seen Spring Break, and they know. They know. They immediately think of James Franco and that ridiculous grill.
That fucking grill, dude. Those fucking braids. Oh, my God. Andrew, please enlighten us.
Oh, I just had a few things. I wanted to be able to talk intelligently about this film. So I looked back at the other Harmony Korine movies.
Yeah, okay.
And I haven't seen them, but I watched a lot of trailers and clips.
You've seen
today.
Kids, though, right?
We
talked about this
saw
before
kids
the show.
Way back on VHS, rented it.
From weird fucking movie.
The dirty video store. You couldn't get it at every video store.
Sad movie.
The
That's
dirty
like
one.
Requiem for a Dream, watching kids.
Totally agree.
Anyway, in watching the other trailers and stuff, I think this other guy's videos, this other films, are worth watching.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? I think,
I really enjoy Harmony Korine as a filmmaker.
Yeah. The Gummo's got some character.
If you've not seen Gummo, you should really see Gummo. It's weird as fuck, man.
I'm sad it was on Netflix
for
a long time, and I never watched it because it just didn't seem interesting.
No. Totally.
But
you didn't know that it was the same guy that made Spring Breakers.
I know.
Or you totally would have watched
it. I watched one little clip, and I'm like, the clip where they're
here's a spoiler.
The cowboys are shooting the kid with the pink bunny ears.
Not even a spoiler.
Tears me up.
I'm pretty sure it's that you can still rent it down at Family Video. I've seen Gummo there.
Wow. I'd have to imagine.
It's there if you want to go rent it, dude.
I've honestly not seen any other Harmony Korine movies.
Really? You've not even seen Kids?
My one and only. He didn't direct it. He wrote it.
Well,
he
wrote it. He had a big part in it.
Now, the other movie.
Like, what's that Tarantino one with
Brad
Christian
Pitt.
Slater and.
It's Brad Pitt on the couch. I know what you're talking about.
Brad Pitt on a couch?
Yeah, he plays the stoner.
Nah, dude, that's Gary Oldman.
No, Brad Pitt's in it, motherfucker.
You're wrong.
No, I'm looking it up right now. Keep talking.
It's okay. True Love. Or
yeah.
True Romance.
True Lies.
And it's Gary Oldman. It's not True Lies. It's True Romance, motherfucker. It's Gary Oldman on the couch. Wait. Before you look it up, let's put a bet on this. Because I am 100% sure it's Gary Oldman. Being the Tarantino fan in the room. What is this?
It's Brad Pitt, True Romance.
I think we're talking about two different
passed
people.
Passed out on a fucking couch. He's the stoner, like, lazy slack.
I thought you were talking about, like, the Rasta drug dealer guy.
No, I'm talking about fucking Brad Pitt. He's awesome and fucking, I love this movie.
That's Gary Oldman. I was thinking you were talking about.
No loss bet.
I think it's fine.
Two
I
sides
think we
of
were
the same
right.
coin. Yeah.
We were just thinking of different people.
But he looks like he's passed out on a couch here. I'm just saying.
Also, Brad Pitt doesn't fucking age.
He does not.
It's crazy.
Except in that Benjamin movie.
God damn it.
But then he gets younger.
That's CG. Because we know Brad Pitt doesn't age.
The other movie I really want to see. Of this guy.
His Donkey Boy?
Mr. Lonely.
Oh.
Oh, not Josh.
Do you know about this?
No.
I've
heard about it, but
it's like a village of impersonators. And so there's like a guy who does Michael Jackson. There's a gal who does Marilyn Monroe. There's a Charlie Chaplin. And they all get together in this commune, and they're like, we're going to have the best of all the worlds. We all get to be who we want to be. And it's
so they just go and they are that person now.
Yeah.
This Michael Jackson.
Yeah, you are Michael Jackson, and everybody believes you and they go along with that story. It sounds fascinating. I haven't seen it. But I want to.
Is there a dramatic turn?
He doesn't know. He's not seen it.
I haven't seen it. I don't think so.
Like, what's the hook?
We'll have to watch and find out.
I think it's just bizarre to see all these people like interacting with each other.
I'm into that.
Yeah. And my last note, when this movie first came out, its opening weekend, it was number 6.
Really?
Do you want to guess what number 1 was?
In 2012, number 1 was...
The weekend it came out. And I'll give you a hint. It's an animated movie. was number one at the box office that week?
Toy Story 3.
Despicable Me.
Both wrong. What is it?
I'm going to give you another guess if you want it. Do you want another round?
Yeah. All right.
Another round of guessing.
Can we get another hint?
Prehistoric. Prehistoric.
Oh, okay. It's Ice Age. No. No. All right, hold on.
The dinosaur Pixar movie. I can't think of the name.
No, that was last year.
That was probably not.
That was too soon. It was an. Croods.
The Croods.
That's it. Oh! Yep. Ryan gets it.
I think we both get that.
Number one.
Yeah. I think we both get it. The Croods. Okay.
All right, that's all I got to say. Good right, episode, man. Guys.
Makes sense.
So, are you ready? All right, so I kind of feel like I kind of blew your mind a little bit.
You totally blew my mind.
So I'm ready to wrap this up and blow your mind just a bit more.
Go for it. And I've got no more notes that are worth mentioning.
Complete this analysis. Okay.
It's mostly just like Selena Gomez.
So I'm tying.
I do it.
I'm going to bring things back that you had talked about previously.
Yes.
So one of them, you were questioning James Franco's unceremonious death. Mm-hmm. And then the other was a quote that you had mentioned. Both these things relate.
Specifically with the religion in the video games.
Not the religion, but
Lucifer.
Treat this like a movie. Treat this like a video game. So, in this movie, James Franco wants what Archie has.
Yes.
That's all he desires. Mm-hmm. That's what he wants. The girls just want to have fun. And in a stupidly...
That should have been our bumper. Girls just want to have fun.
But again, this is going to tie back in the end because they say at the very beginning when they perform the first robbery, this is like a fucking movie. Treat it like a fucking video game. None of this matters. The reason that James Franco dies unceremoniously is because he cares. He gets shot because he's not going to achieve what he wants. The girls then go forth and proceed to kick ass and not take hits and fucking one-shot everybody because they are treating it like an action movie. They are treating it like a video game. They are untouchable. They cannot be fucked with. That's why they go in with this... They've never fucking shot guns before this point, and yet they fucking kill everybody, and nobody can hit them because they're video game stars. They're action movie stars. That's the way I'm seeing this ending. You're not as on board with me as I was with the religious thing.
Not as far as...
Talk to me more.
It could be. It's just a shift from what you were going... And then this is like, oh, well, now we're just going to do a video game theme. Why would they not just carry...
Not so much a video game theme, but it is a thing that is mentioned earlier, and they get away with it.
Yeah.
And they, for sure. That's what happens. They are treating it like that. They don't have the investment that James Franco does.
I mean, I agree. It's shot kind of like a video game in which they are just overpowered, going through the people like it's no problem. But this, because they don't care and they're unaffected...
Well, again, all they want to do
necessarily
is push themselves.
Work for me. So that's, then if this is all tying into your religious allegory with whatever, being unaffected, being atheist, is this what is this saying about the religious themes that you're bringing up? I just don't know why,
again,
if this movie is heavy into the religious thing, why it stops that and we're just going
to
do...
They achieved their original goal, which was to... touch and kill God.
Get more, have fun, do dope shit.
Which, and they do it without judgment. And they
stop
do
the bad guy.
They kill
look
God.
Look dope while doing
they
it.
They do that. And they kill God, and they have achieved their goal. And that's why, at the end, they take his car, and they just drive back to college. They've done what they wanted to do. They pushed themselves to that limit. They pushed past God. Now, I mean, this is... Well, Archie... let me clarify. Archie and Alien are not the... ephemeral God and Satan of all the universe, but they are an allegory to it. They are the God and Satan of that universe.
Sure.
And they have conquered that universe, so they move on. Like, once those two are dead, there are obviously going to be more people that step in and fill in the role of God and Satan in that universe of the spring break aspect.
I'll go one further and add to this. I'll deepen the plot.
I love it. Let's all right,
so you have God, Satan, this huge fight. Aliens taken out, Lucifer's taken out. You have Gucci Mane's character taken out. Done. literally there was a battle between God and Lucifer, and these girls are unaffected. They don't care. They're driving that Lamborghini. In the final shot, you see no joy on their face.
No.
Nothing. Because they just fucking care.
No.
Because
it wasn't about the end.
Youth don't fucking care about anything. They're just unaffected, detached from reality and everything.
For sure, so detached.
Like, they don't. This maze will be fucking Minecraft.
Yeah, it was never about the fucking ending. It was just about the journey. They just wanted to fucking have fun.
And even, yeah.
Okay. And that journey is done. And then they take the fucking Lamborghini and they're just going back.
I like it.
And they're going to do what else ever. So, I like it. But yeah, that's really, that's why, again, that line, I think, because again, it's repeated, it's important. The treat it like it's a fucking action movie, it's a fucking video game. That's why they are able to do what they do at the ending. Yeah. Because that's literally the way they are. They aren't affected by the shots. They're like four dudes shooting at him, and none of them hit him, and they fucking one-shot all of them. So
yeah.
That's my thing, man. Again,
I think it's a good thing.
I got really nerdy with this one.
I like it.
I really love this movie.
I love any time you can go into a movie and do this and just bullshit, talk about like anything, pick it apart, like find different things. That's fun. I think that's fun. I think this is a pretty fun podcast.
I think so too, buddy.
This is a pretty fun one.
So let's go out on a note like we always do. Ryan, would you recommend Spring Breakers to the viewers?
I wouldn't recommend it just to everyone, but I think our viewers, I think it's pretty safe to say, I think they could handle it. I think they'd get it. I think they're smarter than the average Joe, but maybe I'm wrong.
Maybe.
Yes, I recommend it.
Okay. I would go the step just a bit further and say, even though you have heard us fully and completely break down this movie,
spoil it.
I don't think we ruined anything for this movie.
I think much like the characters in the movie, it's about the experience of the journey. Like, you know what's going to happen, but the way it's done is just so good.
Yeah.
It's so good. So, it's artfully done.
I absolutely think that you should also see this movie. I am not guaranteeing you will like it. There will be a large chunk of you that probably do not like it, and that's fine, but I think you should see this movie.
Good art makes you question.
Sure. There you go.
It repulses.
All right, man. That's really all I got to say. This was a fucking great episode. I was really looking forward to this one.
I lost you in that one, huh? I did. Yeah, I thought it was a very good episode, too. I didn't know how we were going to talk about Spring Breakers, but I think we fucking did it.
Man, we fucking did it greatly.
I think we did well.
This is one of our better breakdown episodes.
We're going to get like, we're like, yeah, this is the fucking the best. We're fucking awesome. Like, This is the one. People were just like, that was the worst. I'm fucking out.
Well, let's hope so. Let's cling to those people that leave. And, hey, you know, do butt stuff to each other.
Butt stuff forever, y'all.
Ryan, thank you so much for being on the show.
Butt stuff forever.
Butt stuff forever. Thanks, guys. Fuck you. We're out. Done. Bye.
Wow. Podcast.
Butt stuff podcast.
Hi, this is Ryan, and if you liked what you just saw or listened to, please check us out at experiencegrind.com. Find us on facebook.com/experiencegrind, at Twitter over at twitter.com/expgrindpodcast, where Kyle's tweeting out a lot of stuff all the time. And then you can always find us, our podcast, on iTunes, Stitcher, Twitch, or even on YouTube. Find us, just search Experience Grind Podcast. We don't have a channel yet. Stuff super easy to find. But please subscribe. We'll get there to you, make it even easier. And as always, if you like what you saw, we cover mini games and episodes every week. There's sure to be something you love. And as always, grind out.